Lord Jesus bless you all. Going to been a while since I've shared anything from the Lord, anything that really was on my heart that I felt like he wanted me to share. But last night I learned something that I'd seen 100,000 times before and never had put the two together, but I guess the Lord opened up my mind and put these things together. Discussions between people are going to happen. I work in the public around hundreds of people all day long. It's going to happen. You're going to have confrontations. You're going to have differences of opinion. You're going to have things happen. Like I said, I work in the public and I work in a very busy building. Things are just going to happen. That's just how it is. You have different personalities, different way of looking at things. So many different things happen. But what you have to understand is, how are we going to deal with them? We don't always make the right choices. We don't always make the right decisions. Okay? So, somebody was talking to me about this, and they were asking questions, you know, what does God say about dealing with this? And I started talking about, well, Paul talked about this, and Paul talked about that. And then I stopped for a second, and it came to mind to look it up. So I looked it up, and I realized, well, it was one a whole lot greater than Paul that talked about this. But then as I started reading through these verses, it hit me even harder, because then I realized what was really going on. The depth to it, Lord opened up to me just a little bit to really try to grab a hold. And hopefully I can pass this along to you the way that the Lord taught me. But we're going to go over first the verses that initiated the study, okay? Matthew 18, verse 15, it says, "Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone." That's the first step. And said, "If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother." That's the goal. The goal is not to get proven right. The goal is to gain my brother. I want us to be in peace again, okay? "But if he will not hear thee, then take thee two or three or more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established." The reason you're taking the other people is not to gang up on them, but so they can see that, look, it's not me just saying this. This is how it's supposed to be. Okay? Remember, the goal is to win your brother. "And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as a heathen and a publican. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Those verses, you look at the context of those powerful verses right there. We've pulled those verses out many times and used them. But to put all those verses together, to realize that all of that is the same situation. All those verses are dealing with people having trouble amongst each other. This is how I want you to deal with it. Now we're going to go over something else here in just a minute. Like I said, the Lord really loaded me up on this right here. But look right here. I like reading the verses before it and the verses after it to kind of get an idea of what the whole thing was talking about. This is Jesus, and when he speaks, boy, there's something about, it's just power and wisdom that he has that has no equal. Look at the verses before it. Verse 13, "And if it so be that he find it, verily I say unto thee, he rejoices more over that sheep than of 99 which went not astray. Even so, it is not the will of your Father, which is in heaven, that one of these little ones should perish." Verse 11, "For the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost." Huh. Now, let me tell you something that I had... Like I said, I'm no big scholar. I'm just an ordinary man, okay? ordinary man, blessed to be shown the word of God when I was a little boy. Lucky if I ever, or lucky's not the word, but if I'd ever walk 2 days right in a row, it'd be amazing. If I could ever stand up on my own 2 feet and walk a day, that also would be amazing. It's taken the Lord Jesus Christ. I promise you, I have been a busy sheep to the Lord to where he's not only had to, and I'm just going to be honest with this and get that out there, he's not only had to come to me and say, okay, little sheep, come back over here. He's had to take that rod and he's had to crack me on the head with it. I couldn't tell you how many times. He's had to take that shepherd hook and yank me and be like, how many times am I going to have to pull you away from that edge? You're going to fall over. You're going to kill yourself. How many times am I going to have to come to you and pull you over? But here's what you got to understand about Jesus. He is all about his sheep. He is the shepherd that has no equal. He gave his life for the sheep. Okay? He took their place. In order to give something, you have to sacrifice something. If I have and I've made $100, guess what? I have bills to pay. I have things to do. In order for me to turn around and hand that to somebody, I have to sacrifice paying other things. Jesus himself sacrificed a life that he could have come to this earth. He could have been greater than Solomon and had all the riches in this world, but he chose to come and to give his life on the cross for you and me. First and foremost, you have to understand how much Jesus loves his sheep. Because he said that he was going to send. It talks about it in the book of Jeremiah, if I'm not mistaken. He's going to send shepherds that care about his sheep. He's going to send shepherds that know what they're talking about because he's going to give them the food to feed his sheep. A lot of times what we have is shepherds that aren't very good shepherds. I'm not a very liked person because I say things like this. Yet the Lord has given it to me to say things like this. I have the freedom through the Lord Jesus Christ that I don't lose my job as preacher because I speak the truth that he gives me. I'm not worthy to say his name because I make more mistakes than all of you put together. But he gave me the freedom. As many times as I've gotten upset, as many times I'm like, Lord, out here, this is what you want me to do. You want me to share out here on these videos? You want me to share out here typing little things up for people to read? You want me to share out here walking around in this big building and people? This is what you want me to do. I can stand up and speak the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. I can stand up and speak the truth because I can't lose what I have. You can't take away from me what I don't have. I have no title. I'm just a voice in the wilderness. That's all I am. I'm just a parrot on a tree limb. That's all I am. Master came and told me what to say, and I'm saying it. Doesn't bother me who likes it, who doesn't like it. Lord Jesus Christ told me very plainly one time. These men and women are going to the place called hell. And whoever I've given the ability to share and to speak to, if they don't tell them, then their blood's on their hands. I've shared to family members the truth that God's given me and told them right face to face that God said, you need to turn to him. God said, when are you coming back to him? When are you going to give up this life? When are you going to repent and come to him? When are you going to give up this life that you're in and turn to the Lord Jesus and bring Jesus in your family? I've had to do that. I've had to share the truth that God's given me. Because I think I'm somebody? No, sir. Because I don't want to see the sheep get lost. Because I don't want to see the sheep die when they didn't have to. It's not a setting that everybody pats you on the back and you did a great job. It's not what it's about, guys. Guess what? I'm getting ready to share something with you that wasn't somebody just wrote it. It was my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ said it himself. You have the authority through the Lord Jesus Christ as his sheep to go to another sheep and try your best to straighten out a quarrel. It's not the Lord's will to post it. It's not the Lord's will to ask your neighbor. It's not the Lord's will for you to share it over here. It's not the Lord's will to share it over there. It's the Lord's will that you follow the order that he gave. You don't get to pick and choose what you think you should do. And this is just as much for me as it is for anybody out there. This is the Lord's words. Oh, but it causes trouble. Let me tell you something. There's more hornet's nest trouble right now in God's people than you can imagine. There's more trouble that comes up from stirring up a situation and not handling it. I've seen it. I've seen it 1,000 times. I'm smack dab right in the middle of it more times than you can count. You need to take care of the situation now until before it grows into this monster that you cannot control. It amazed me last night when I was reading these verses. That's his steps. His steps, very plainly. One-on-one. Go sit down and talk about it. With one thing in mind, trying to get past it. Number two, if you don't listen, take people with you. Number three, if they don't want to listen to you or the witnesses, take it before the church. You know how many churches today are willing to do that? I'd be amazed if there's this many. Why? Because we're so worried about the cliques being broke up. We're so worried about putting on the spot. Oh, well, you know, so-and-so, it's okay. But this person, we don't really want to hurt their feelings. Let me tell you something. I learned as a boy, I was raised by a man, and boy, he loved God. He loved Jesus so much. One day his son got into some things that he shouldn't have got into. And he was a member of that church. And I remember that man standing up with his son and telling him, "My son has let the Church of Jesus down. My son has sinned against God in this church. And my son will take the responsibility of his actions. As a church, what do you think we should do?" I was that boy. And I deserved it. I remember I couldn't cut the grass for a month or two, which I loved getting paid for mowing the grass. So there was 2 or 3 months that I basically didn't have a job. I was put aside. I was almost like he was just setting me down at a timeout. Boy, I remember crying. I was upset. And I was a young boy. I was probably 12, 13 years old. I had to go apologize to people that knew about what I had gotten into. But I learned. That's the right way to do things. And then my dad was not going to be a respecter of persons. At the time, I was mesmerized by it. But as I get older, I realize how much more my dad loved God than I ever dreamed of. That even his son, he's like, we're going to do what God says. You know how hard it is right now to find a preacher, a pastor that'll do that? It doesn't matter who they are. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter who it is that's doing wrong. If they're doing wrong, they're doing wrong. Look, God loves you. God loves me. But I'm going to tell you right now, this three-step process right here, God does himself with every one of us. God first comes to you alone, one-on-one, and shows you the sin that's in your life. I know more about the sin in this world. I know more about the fights of this devil than people could imagine. And it's not because I'm better. It's because I've been right smack dab in it. It's because I have been in this world. I know what this world's all about. And I'm no better than anyone. But let me tell you something. God uses this same exact thing in our lives. He comes to us one-on-one. We don't listen. What does he do? He brings to us 2 to 3 witnesses trying to reach us. Trying to reach us. Trying to get to us. Trying to help us. Then what does he do? He takes it to the church. He uses the whole body of Christ to reach us, to try to get the gospel to us, to try to get us to turn from sin. He uses his whole church to try to reach us. Guess what happens, guys, if we still don't want to listen to him? He said, you turn from them, and to them you are heathen or publican. That's what God does. God finally turns, and he says, you know what? You don't want to listen? You live in your own sin. You live in your own life. What he does. A wise man, Proverbs says, listens to wise counsel. My friend, one-on-one, we're always going to have issues. But when 2 or 3 people take the time to sit down and talk to you about what you're doing wrong, or what you said was wrong, or how you offended them, or how you did something, guess what? People just need to get over it. People just need, let me tell you something. That's from Satan. That's from Satan is what that is. Because the child of God would love like God does. God wants you back. God wants you back to him. God's the one who doesn't care what's happened out there. The father says, all I know is that my child was dead and now they're alive again. The brother that's evil from Satan himself, well, you never did anything like this for me. Well, I've been here this whole time. I ain't never got this kind of treatment. That's a Satan's child is what that is. Another thing that I never thought of, I've heard it preached for 1,000 years. Or, sorry, 1,000 messages. Sorry, I'm excited. The Lord's all over me. And I can't handle it hardly. And once again, look, I'm not better. This is what the Lord gave me to share. I ain't been able to share anything in a while, and this has blessed me. So I'm going to share what God's given me. We always talk about the lost sheep. Very interesting thought crossed my mind last night when I was reading those verses. I thought, you know what? How interesting that the verse that talks about how we're supposed to deal with things one-on-one with the church by Jesus, not just by somebody down the road. This is what Jesus said to do. I'm pretty sure that if Jesus said to do it that way, that's the only way to do it. Okay? Y'all can believe whatever you want to, but Jesus said, do it this way. And if you read the verses following all of this, how many times are you supposed to forgive them? And you don't understand. They've done this to me 20 times. 7 times 70. Figure that out. If they keep doing it, then you keep forgiving them. Why? Because that's what Jesus does to you. Because that's what Jesus does to me. He keeps coming to me out of everybody in this world that keeps, oh, well, you're backslidden. Oh, well, you're this. Oh, well, you're that. Jesus keeps coming to me and says, you know, we can work through this. You're mine. I want you to share this. I want you to. That's who Jesus is, okay? So Jesus forgives us. Jesus wants us. Jesus doesn't just throw us to the wolves and say, ah, whatever. No, he keeps coming to us and tries to get us. Because he wants a relationship with us. He is right. He could stand back and he could, I'm in the one in the right, and you all just go whatever. No, he wants us to be with him. He wants to rectify the situation. He wants to pull us to his feet. He wants to hug us. He went to the cross because that was commanded by the Father to come to us and love us. Because God, yet, and when we were yet sinners, he came to us and wanted to save us. He's not coming to us to prove his point. He's coming to us to save us. He didn't come to judge. He didn't come to condemn. We were condemned already. He came to save mankind. Lord, mercy. Thank you for your grace. These verses about a sheep are right before this verse we're talking about here about how the church is supposed to handle this. Okay? This is how it is. While I was reading it this time, it changed in my mind. He's talking about sheep. We don't think nothing about it. We think, oh, well, you know, a lost sheep. Somebody out there that's never been saved. I don't believe so. What do you mean? Well, there's a verse in the New Testament later on that he talks about that God one day is going to divide the sheep from the goats. The goats are not saved. The sheep are. The fact that he used this story about sheep is deeper than we realize. Okay? He leaves 99 sheep. And I started thinking, why is that one sheep run off by himself? We always think backslidden. That's the first thing that comes out of our mouth is backslidden. I personally learned last night that the next section of verses after the sheep been lost has to do with somebody who's done something wrong to somebody else in the church. Has a lot more to do with why that sheep's lost than we realize. What does Jesus do? He leaves the 99 and goes after the one. Why is that one by himself? Was he picked on? Was he run off? Was he ignored? Was he called names? Who knows? There's a very good possibility that that one sheep that's out there by himself, he was run away by the other ones. You look at how the Pharisees were. They were. He said it himself. He told them, you're running more people off than you're bringing people in. You go over land and sea to make one proselyte, and then you turn around and you make him worse than the devil. When you don't even go in yourselves. If our agenda in the church, outside the church, I don't care where it is, it's to have cliques of little Christian groups that we just talk about everybody, that we just talk about this, then, oh, well, we're the group, we're the clique. Then guess what? You're serving Satan. Because it's a sin to do that. It's a sin to think that we're better than one another. It's a flat-out sin. And guess what sin does? Sin brings in death. And death leads to hell. So guess what you've done? You've used one of the Satan's devices. Oh no, I know Satan's devices. Well, let me be the first one to tell you, you're more ignorant of Satan's devices than you've ever thought of. Why's that? Because you need to read 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and learn what Satan's devices is all about. Paul comes to this church and tells them, look, I'm sending this guy to you. And I know you've caused trouble before with this guy. I know he's let you down. I know he's done things. But I'm going to tell you right now that I forgave him because Christ forgave me. I forgave him. He's been ministering to me. He's been a huge blessing to me. Sorry, but this flesh can't handle all this. I'm going to tell you right now. Paul tells him. He said, look, this guy here, basically, you need to learn. You need to remember. He's so hurt. So many other things are going on in his life right now. Be careful pushing somebody to the side and pounding on somebody and beating them up and talking bad about them and saying things. Why? Lest he be overwhelmed with sorrow. My guy, friends, he's talking about a depressive state. I'm all about those. All about depressive state. So why you? Yeah, me. I'm human just like anybody else. I've got to where I got pretty thick skin when it comes to people's comments. But I stop and I think about, why would you say that about people? Why would you say that to people? Here we are trying to our best to bring people to Jesus. Why would you talk to them that way? Let me tell you something. Why don't you try this sometime? Next time you haven't seen somebody in a while, you just say hi, nice to see you. How have you been? I've missed you. Leave out every other word that you think you need to say to correct somebody. Why? Because they're not your servant. They're not your servant to talk to about that. You say, well, God gives his word. If God gives it to you, that's different. If God didn't give it to you, then keep your mouth shut. Because a lot of times, you're not the biggest blessing you think you are. A lot of times, what comes out of your mouth is probably not what God wants coming out of people's mouth. And look, I'm not telling you that because I'm better. I'm telling you that because I've had to learn that. I'm telling you that because this right here is my worst enemy some days. And I've had to apologize and eat my own words and stick both my feet in my mouth because I said the wrong things or said something I shouldn't have said to somebody. We're all that way. Every one of us. I don't care the biggest blessing you think you are to everybody. Guess what? There's a lot of times that Satan uses all of us. Oh, well, I don't know. Let me tell you something. The Apostle Peter was blessed to be standing right beside Jesus, and yet Jesus turned around and told him, hey, Satan, get behind me. Guess who was getting used by Satan? One of the apostles. Closer student to Jesus than me and you could ever realize. As a church, as people, we get caught up in so many silly things. We get caught up in things that we think are so important. Let me tell you what's important in God's eyes. Number one, obedience. Number one, obedience. Number two, winning souls. That's God's agenda. Winning souls, winning people's lives for Christ Jesus, through Christ Jesus, blood and sacrifice. That is what's in God's agenda. The color of your churches, the color of your buildings, how many showed up, all these other things, way back in the back of God's plan. He wants to deal with people's hearts. He wants to help people. He wants them to be able to work together. A lot of times, we keep talking about this. We love when God moves in our service and we can feel the presence of our Lord. And boy, we're jumping up and down and everybody's good. Guess what also happens? Sometimes also happens that old flesh takes over. Every one of us, just the same way. And what do we do when that happens? Oh, it was your fault. Oh, it was your fault. Oh, it was your fault. Guess what, guys? Sometimes it's our fault, too. Sometimes my mouth's what started it all. Sometimes it's me. know what the hardest thing for a person to do to accept the Lord Jesus Christ is? You would think it's believing that all this stuff happened. Nope, it's not. I asked God one time. I was walking through, and remember a job I had before, I was walking through one day and I asked God, I said, God, you know, I've only got 2-3 minutes sometimes, and I'm having a hard time explaining to people, what are we fighting here? What is it that keeps men out of heaven? My son, one word, pride. I started walking, I stopped for a second, and I thought, pride. Then I started thinking, boy, it's about right. Because if they don't confess with their mouth that they're sinners and they need help, nothing moves forward. Number one, it's usually pride. I have the authority to do this, 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 and this. It's a good way to get ourselves in trouble right there, buddy. Best way, best practice to be is the Lord asked me to share this. That's the best practice. The Lord asked me to share this. You start getting to, I have the authority and I have the this and my position says this. Look, I've learned with dealing with people, that don't go over very well. That usually triggers a lot of pushback right off the bat. My friends, if we're really trying to gain a brother, if we're really trying to gain a fellow Christian, we've talked a lot about different things in this little video here the Lord's blessed me with, and I learned quite a bit last night in a short time. And let me tell you something, I was sitting on my couch, and I was studying, I was reading through things, and the Lord was right there sharing with me, because the Lord knew that, well, this body, it can only handle so much. I was just amazed at, Lord, wow, man, huh, never thought about that, never thought about this. Here's the key to it all. What are we really after? If you're after proving your point, guess what, guys? Good luck with that. It's not what I'm after. I'm not after proving people that the Bible's real. It's not my goal. I'm not after proving everybody that Jesus died on the cross. It's not my job. I've realized that my biggest challenge is not out here trying to get people to accept the fact that God uses me. It's not my challenge either. You know what my challenge is? I'm going to tell you what my challenge is. My challenge, I'm reminded of my absolute favorite teacher in this world, my absolute favorite, because he's my Lord and Savior. His name's Jesus. It's two things. Love God Father. Put Him above all things. Thank Him so much for Jesus, His Son. Number two, to love all these neighbors around me as God's loved me. He said if we could get those two, that all the others would fall into place. And he's right. Our biggest enemy is respecter of persons, though. Satan wants us to be, and you look through all the scriptures, Satan wants us to be respecter of persons, because then that means I'm going to pick and choose who I love, and God didn't give me that choice. God sent his son Jesus Christ to this world to die on the cross and to give his blood for the whole world, not just a select few. He'd had to do it for everybody so that what he did was just. I have to love everybody. I don't get to pick and choose who I love. And it's hard at times. It's hard to love the one standing there cussing you. It's hard to love the one that you know that they just wish you got fired today. It's hard to love the one that you don't want to listen to you talk. It's hard to love the one that backstabbed you, treated you. Maybe you'd use respect for persons over you. But you know what? That's what Jesus asked me to do. That's been my battle here lately. My battle's not getting up Sunday morning going to church. My battle's not getting up Sunday or Wednesday and going to church. It's not my battle. I'm trying my best to focus on one little battle at a time. My biggest battle right now is just to love everybody equally. To be a discerner of spirits. To be a discerner of God's gifts. To start looking for, okay, Lord, you've given me these gifts. Let's use them. Help me understand who needs my help. See that person over there screaming and cussing? That person over there that's mad at the world? Need you to go help them. Really? Okay. That's what I need you to do. It's one person at a time. It's real easy to go help that person over there. It's real easy when you, I proved my point. I said what I said and they're all, you know, everybody realizes I'm right. You know what's not easy? Sorry guys, I've lost it. The day I got upset, apologize. I'm the reason this service went the way that it went. I'm the reason, Lord, that this Bible study went the way that it went. I didn't come in with a good attitude. I'm sorry. I have had these little clicks. I have had these little things. I do like being around certain people more than I do others. Sorry, Lord Jesus. Apologize to you people. Like if you're going to be a good shepherd, you're going to have to learn to love all the sheep. Or you're not going to make it as a shepherd. You got to love all the sheep. And I'm pretty sure that's what the Lord's been teaching me here lately. It's a hard season to love sheep. Love God's people. Love people in general. Remember, not all of them are sheep. Some of them's goats. But I don't get to pick and choose. I gotta love them all. Anyway, this is what the Lord Jesus gave me. Whatever you're doing, whatever this God used this whole thing to help you, look, don't look at me. You go to Jesus. Tell him, Jesus, thank you for sending one witness to me. Because I promise you, he has sent thousands of witnesses to me. He has used thousands of different church groups to help me. It's because Jesus loves us. Don't let the enemy divide you. The enemy don't like it when we come together. That's why the Father sent Jesus to us, so there wouldn't be a division between us anymore. Jesus loves you all. Hope this blesses you. Pray for me. I'm out here still learning. God bless you all. Y'all have a good day.